state your name for the camera?
Mark Wayne Morton.
Okay. And can you tell us what years did you attend Linda McKinley? How old were you in 1971 and what grade were you in?
I attended Linda McKinley 1970 through 72. I was 71, I would have been 18, but it doesn't really match up, so I guess I was 17.
And what grade were you in 71?
The 11th grade.
So, as a youth, well, first of all, can you tell us a little bit about where you're from and how you came to be in the Linden area? Did you grow up there? Did you move there?
Well, my family moved into a housing project called Windsor Terrace in 1959. We moved there from the east side of Columbus. And as a result of moving into Windsor Terrace, we fed into Linda McKinley High School.
I see. And as a youth, as a boy, as a teenager, were you aware of the political and social turmoil that was happening in the country at that time?
Yes.
And what were your thoughts?
Basically, my thoughts were that I understood some of the protests and the reason for some of the protests that were going around the nation at that time, such as riots in Huff, Detroit, out in Los Angeles, and various other cities, and even Columbus. But I didn't understand the nature of where they took place. For whatever the protest was for, whether it was for police killing or just unfair practices, it just seems to me that the destruction should have taken place elsewhere and not where we lived.
Mm-hmm. And what was your sense of, you know, you mentioned police brutality and or police killings and unfair practices. So what was your sense of the political movements themselves, not just the protests, but the actual movements? Were you aware of groups that were organized or, you know, that were trying to do community work in black communities?
Yes, we had worked with a brother, Nomo X, who had a organization on Livingston Avenue at the time. We also worked with St. Stephen's Community House, which was on Cleveland Avenue in the Linden area. It was ran by a gentleman named John Maloney, who was very sympathetic to the plight of black folks. We also worked with gentleman Clarence Lumpkins, who was well known in the city of Columbus. He didn't actually have an organization or head an organization at the time, but he had a lot of political affiliation. We also met several times with Jim Roseboro and Jerry Hammond. And I think at the time, Jim Roseboro was running for mayor, and Jerry Hammond was running for city council. And so we had discussions with them many times. We were also aware of other persons that were running for city council, and also the governorship of Ohio. I also recall at that time that our present mayor, who was Mayor Thomas Moody, had been stopped for driving intoxicated. He got away by saying it became famous at that time, or should I say infamous at that time, that he was inspecting the city. And that's how he got away with the DUI. And so, you know, it became a joke in the black community that if I get stopped, I'm gonna say I'm inspecting the city. So
can I ask you also about your awareness of national movements that were happening? As a teenager, were you aware of national movements happening?
We were very much aware of the Black Panthers, of SNCC, of CORE, of the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, and all the things that they were doing at that time. We really took the liking to STIC, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, and what their agenda was.
So can you talk a little bit about the racial makeup of the Linden community when you were there? And also, was there racial tension at Linden McKinley High School while you were there? Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, as far as the Linden area was concerned, when we first moved to Windsor Terrace, it was said that you do not go past Hudson Street because there was almost 100% white people, and that there was racial tension, and that you may have to fight your way back home. So we didn't travel north of Hudson. Prior to that, even when we moved to Windsor Terrace, there were still white families who were living south of Hudson. But they quickly moved out and moved further north or moved to the suburbs. And so when they moved out, black families moved into their homes. Those that were able to buy homes moved into their homes because they were just a little bit better than the homes from 17th Avenue south to 11th Avenue. The homes from 17th to Hudson were better maintained. And so that's why a lot of the families begin to move into that area.
Sorry, I was muted. So what about at the school? Did you feel that kind of tension at the school?
No, I honestly feel that that the racial tensions at Linden McKinley did not really exist. We played ball with the male white students. The females, black and white, seemed to get along together. We got along together with some of the white females. And it was all, I thought it was all well until they did the drop in the auditorium.
Okay, okay. So before we get into that, let me ask you about the administration itself and the school itself. Did you feel when you were a student, were the students treated the same? Were black students treated differently than white students or not? And how would you describe the administration?
Well, the administration at Linda McKinley was pretty good. Mr. Brown was always there to help us out. I forgot who was Mr. Reed was the principal. Now he was a different story. And I forgot who the third person was. We had three principals. There were two white and Mr. Brown was black. But as far as the administration go, we really didn't have any issues with them until they asked John Wells to speak to us.
And can you talk a little bit about that?
Well, there had been an ongoing issue with people leaving their plates and trays on the tables in the cafeteria rather than cleaning up after themselves after lunch. The administration, especially Mr. Reed, seemed to think that it was only black students who were doing that. When in actuality, there were black women who had to come and clean the cafeteria. And so we actually helped them in picking up behind students because we didn't want those black women to have to come behind us. And so we felt that if we had black awareness of certain issues, then we needed to do our part and help them out. And so when they asked John Wells to come into the gymnasium and speak to us about that, I personally did not like that. That's where I famously called him an Uncle Tom. But we were all, as I said, we were already helping out. There was a group of us who after we ate lunch, which we ate lunch the last period, and that was just a thing that we wanted to, there were certain students we wanted to be in the cafeteria at the same time. And so we all ate the last lunch period. And so we were there to help them clean up. And so when he began to accuse us of not helping to clean up after ourselves, that really bothered me. And so that's when he and I had our first confrontation. Which almost spilled into a fist fight, but other students intervened, and so it was really just a matter of me calling him an Uncle Tom and he being removed from the gymnasium.
And can you talk about how your relationship with John Wells evolved and were you a part of the group of black students who were meeting at his house outside of school?
Well, John Wells and I actually met each other when I was trying out for football. He was a senior that year, and as an 11th grader, I was trying out for football. And I had was playing a guard position, and I had flew off the line and knocked the person, the defensive person, backwards. And in fact, I broke his collarbone that I flew off so fast. And so John Wells was there at the practice, and he told the coach to let him come in as the defensive player. And so when they hiked the ball, he beat me to the punch, and he flew into my shins, which kind of stopped me, stopped my forward progress. And that was my first introduction to John Wells. Later on, we kind of, you know, nodded to each other on days that we were both in the alcove. He kind of took great pride in the fact that he was able to stop me in my tracks. And I, of course, did not like his glowing about that. And so we never really had words, but it was just an uneasy feeling between the two of us. And then when we were in the gymnasium that day, not only did I think he was wrong in what he was saying, but I also thought, okay, here's a chance to fire off back at him.
And so,
could I interrupt for 1 second?
I need to close something so there's no noise during the interview.
Sorry, I just had to wait 1 second until it was over.
Okay.
Cool, just take me 1 second here. I want to close this.
Sure.
One of my friends was trying to chat to me. I'm like, not now, not now. All right. And then that's so funny. What you said is John Wells submarined you. That's terrible. So
yeah.
You pulled off the line as a guard and did a stunt, right? And so you're coming around, and he knew you were coming, and so he submarined you,
yeah.
Which was bad. That's not good. Like, you're not supposed to submarine people. That's kind of dirty, you know?
Yeah.
And was he playing linebacker then? Because that's usually who'd run up on that guard, right? Was he like an outside linebacker?
Well, they put him in as a defensive lineman.
Oh, defensive end, huh?
Yeah.
So when you pulled and you came down the line for the sweep or whatever, or option, he was there, so he went after your left.
Yeah.
That's tough, man.
Yeah.
I know, that's really tough, yeah.
Yeah, it was tough.
And that's how you guys met, right?
Yeah.
So, but you hit that other guy so hard you broke his collarbone.
Yeah.
And what did coach say? He's starting? I'm sorry, I'll let you get back to it. We're all set now, I'll close the window.
Yeah, no, coaches, you know, thought it was great because they thought they had a problem with me firing off the line. But there was no problem with me with that. The only problem with me in trying out for high school football was that a number of these students had played little league ball, and I did not. And so they had some advantages over me as far as what you're to do on the football field. And so John Wells had played little league ball, and he knew that. But you're right, it was a kind of a dirty move. You know, I thought if he had just took me one-on-one in a block, you know, I would have put him down also.
It's not what you do. It's not necessarily dirty, but it's not what you do to a teammate in practice. It's
right.
Just not, you know. Yeah.
So, Mr. Morton, I want to I want to go back to a couple things that you mentioned to me, and I wondered if you could talk about them a little bit. One thing that you mentioned was when there was Soul Food Day in the cafeteria, and you said that the white students did not purchase lunch. And I wonder if you could talk about that a little bit. And then also, if you could tell us about the alcove, what it was.
Okay, on the Soul Food Day, we had had a committee that was working with the administration as far as what we wanted to see during Black History Month. So one of the things we wanted was a Soul Food Day, where we had things that we were used to eating at home. And so we had barbecue ribs, collard greens, sweet potatoes, macaroni and cheese, the traditional things that Black people had on celebratory days. Mr. Reed, the principal, when he got on the mic to make the morning announcements, he called the greens Collard greens, which was funny. But no white students, we didn't see any white students come in and purchase any of the soul food. And in fact, we didn't know that this was going to take place, but they had two menus. They had a small, they had prepared some other dishes that they kept in the back for the white students to purchase, which was the everyday menu, which was mostly a hamburger in between a bun with gravy poured on it. And we were just a little tired of that, and that's why we went for the Soul Food Day. But they did have a small menu for the white kids, and so they didn't have to buy the soul food menu. They were able to purchase the regular menu.
Interesting. So can you tell us what the alcove was?
The alcove was an area across from the cafeteria that when they built the school, they built this little area that had benches in it. And it was recessed back from the main hallway. There was a hallway that went from the front of the school all the way to the rear of the school. And the alcove would just recess back off of that hallway. And it had a number of benches and tables where Black students congregated every day. We were there in the morning before school. We were there at recess, the morning recess. We went to the alcove, and at lunchtime, we went to the alcove. Even if you weren't, even if it was not your time to eat, we still would be in the alcove. It was just our place together at Linden.
And was the alcove shut down, and can you talk about that?
When the police occupied Linden, yeah, it was shut down. We could not gather anymore in the alcove.
Okay. So I'm gonna go back to this group. Were you a part of the group of students that was meeting at John Wells' house? And if you were, what was the group about? What did you talk about?
Well, after I called John, the day that I called John Wells, and Uncle Tom, he invited certain students to come to his house and let's meet and talk about why I thought he was an Uncle Tom and to discuss some other issues that was of importance to the Black students. And So yes, I did go over to his house. We did sit down and discuss while I called him and Uncle Tom. And we also discussed some of the things that we thought were important to happen at Lyndon McKinley.
What were those things?
Such as our curriculum, our history, especially our history. Even though we did have black history black history studies, we had two black teachers that taught that, but we also had to take history lessons, and those did not contain any of the things that were that we wanted to see. We didn't see any of our history in those books. Also in some of the other classes, like we had to take health classes, we know by some of our uncles and fathers that there began to be talks about illnesses that were germane to black men. And we never talked about that in health. And so we wanted the health curriculum to be more guided toward black men and just black people in general.
So can you talk about how the presence of Gary Davis and Bruce Bunch and even Tom Brown, how did those men being in the school, how did that affect black students?
Well, Mr. Brown being the principal did a great job of not allowing us to be put in positions of being expelled from the school. He had his form of punishments that were much more lighter than Mr. Reed or the other principal. Mr. Brown would sometimes take us into his office, give us a good talking, sometimes involved curse words, sometimes he did not. When he did, we did not mind that because we thought that this was a black man that was concerned about our well-being. And so whatever he said to us, we took it to heart. And we tried to improve ourselves and our conduct while we were there at Lyndon McKinley. Mr. Bunch and Mr. Davis had the Black History curriculum, and so everybody tried to sign up for their classes. And we had some really good discussions in their classes. Discussions that went all the way from pimps and hustlers, players, to Marcus Garvey, Frederick Douglass, Sojourner Truth, and some of the black people who were famous that we just didn't read about in the regular history class.
I see. And so I'm going to go into 1971 now and ask you about the Black History Week performance in February of 1971. And can you tell us, were you there? What happened? What did you see? And what was going through your mind?
Yeah, we were in the auditorium at Lyndon McKinley. And we were having a program. for Black History Month. We were about probably halfway through the program when a white guy runs into the balcony and throws a bunch of pamphlets over the balcony down to the main floor. We took a brief look at those pamphlets, and some of us didn't even look at the pamphlets, just the fact that this gentleman came into the balcony, shouted a couple racial slurs, and threw the pamphlets was enough to get some of the black male students running out of the auditorium to try to catch him. But up until that point, Black History Month had been going smooth and there hadn't been any issues. But it was just this gentleman who came in and shouted the racial slurs and threw those pamphlets. And that just started hell at Linda McKinley for the rest of that year.
Did you see the pamphlets yourself?
Yes.
And what did they say?
They also had racial slurs in them. We were referred to as nigger students and things like that. There really wasn't anything substantive in the pamphlets. It was mostly just a bunch of racial slurs and some things that were putting down the African-American race. Okay, no, I knew who he was. I don't recall his name, but I did know who he was. We had played football together at recess.
And were you surprised that he had done that? Especially
yes. Yeah, I was surprised that anyone would have interrupted, that any of the white students would have interrupted the Black History Month programs. We had done this in previous years, and there had not been any problems. And so it was really unexpected that it happened. And besides the big guy who threw the pamphlets over, there were some other white students who accompanied him, who we joked around with and ate lunch with, played ball with. I mean, some of these guys were as active with us as other male black students. And so the whole incident was just a total surprise to all of us. It was a surprise, but at the end of the day, we thought, okay, they were just acting white.
Gotcha. Can you talk a little bit about how that incident in February changed things at the school?
Well, after the incident in February, then there became some heated racial tensions in the school. There were fights almost every day between male black students, between male black and white students. That occurred almost every day. And we were put in different classrooms, and that made a difference also. They tried to change the room so that there wasn't as many black and white students in the same classrooms. But when the class was over, we still met in the hallways. And that's when a lot of the racial tensions really spilled out.
I see. So the administration kind of tried to segregate you, to keep the peace.
Yeah. Or
so
to protect the white boys.
And let's go to May. First of all, were you a part of the march from Lyndon McKinley High School to Franklin Park on May 19th?
Celia, one second. Mr. Morgan was trying to expand really quickly on that last answer.
I'm sorry. It's muffled on my end and I'm not. Okay, go ahead and please finish what you wanted to say. I'm sorry.
You had asked about did the administration segregate us.
Yes.
Yeah. And I had said that, that they segregated us, for the purpose of not having so much of each other in the classrooms. But what I was saying, was trying to say was that the segregation was for the white boys.
I see.
Yeah.
How so?
So that they would not have to be in the classes with us. They were in classes with young black females, but they were not in classes with the black males. I think ultimately the answer to that would probably be yes, because there was a fight every day. And so not only were the white students afraid to be in classes with the black males and some black females, the teachers were afraid. Yeah, and I think that was probably what propelled the segregation move probably more than anything else. The teachers were afraid.
So, Mr. Morton, were you a part of the march from Lyndon McKinley to Franklin Park on May 19th?
Yes. Proud to say that I was the one who came up with the idea. Now, John Wells may tell you different, but I was the one who came up with the idea. We met with some Ohio State University students on a Sunday afternoon, and they asked what we might could do, and I came up with the suggestion that we would march from Lyndon McKinley to Franklin Park on May 19th. In celebration of Malcolm X's birthday. But yeah, I did march from Lyndon to Franklin Park.
And can you tell us what that was like? What it was like along the way and what it was like when you got there? Who took part in it and how did the public respond?
Well, I would think we probably probably had a good 90 to 100% of the black students that participated. No white students participated, which we didn't think they would. The march itself was a peaceful march. We had given instructions before we left Lyndon that if you started with the march, we expected you to end with the march. We didn't want you going, we didn't want any of the students going into any of the carryouts or stores along the way. We wanted everybody to just stay with the march. And we had instructions that since the police, we had no cooperation from the Columbus City Police as far as traffic control. We asked the students to be mindful of the marshals we had that would stop us at intersections and then would lead us out into the intersection when it was safe. And that all went well. We marched our way down to East Broad and Parkwood, which is where East High School is located. We then stood in front of East High School because we anticipated that some of their students may come out and join us for the end of the march and march over into Franklin Park with us. Instead, we got the principal, Mr. Jack Gibbs, and we folded up a Black Nationalist flag, which was red, black, and green flag, and we gave that to Mr. Gibbs, which he grudgingly accepted. And then we moved on. We found out that later on, Mr. Gibbs accused Mr. Brown, Mr. Bunch, and Mr. Davis of being the ones who started that march and caused confusion in front of his school. But it was not the principals or the teachers that started that. But Mr. Brown was instrumental in helping us pull this off. He drove us around Columbus between Linden and Franklin Park so that we could pick what we thought was the safest route. He also helped us with coming up with the pass that had to be signed by the parents to allow the students to leave the school and to march to Franklin Park. And he was there marching with us. Mr. Brown marched from Linden to Franklin Park with us. There were, I'm not sure of the dates. We had a meeting at Mount Hermon Baptist Church, and we had a meeting at Bethel AME Church, which was real close to Linden. Now, I'm not sure if that's the one on the 24th, but as far as importance, that one was probably more important. The meeting at Mount Hermon Church, we had a lot of parents who came out who had their feelings about what young black people were doing, and they expressed them. And that was probably the gist of that meeting. The meeting at Bethel AME Church was attended by most of the persons who met over John Wells' house on a daily basis. Young lady, Annette Toots, her mother attended. We had a couple of students that were there that didn't regularly meet at John Wells, such as a guy named Jerome Barton, And that's probably all that I can remember.
Who was the safety director at that meeting?
Yeah, Jim Hughes was there with a couple of police officers. Charles Ross was there. Jim Hughes was the Columbus safety director. He informed us at that meeting that police officers would occupy Lyndon McKinley the very next day, which was very upsetting to us. And the young lady, Annette Toots, began to cry, and that kind of brought the tears from the rest of the students. Jerome Barton got so teed off about it that he went after Jim Hughes, and he was stopped by the police officers that accompanied him there. And what's ironic about that is that Jerome Barton later became a sergeant with the Columbus Police Department. Another person I believe was there, his name was Gary McCants. And I'm not sure why Gary was there. I often thought that he was just there to feed somebody information on what we were meeting about. Gary McCants also became a police officer, and in fact became the bodyguard to Mayor Reinhart, who was a mayor in Columbus. Well, the meeting ended with us being just totally frustrated and pleading with Jim Hughes not to have the Columbus police occupy our school. He said it was because of our actions, meaning the black students, because of our actions, that they had to occupy Lyndon McKinley to restore order. And so it ended when they left. You know, he made it clear to us that that was going to take place. So when he left, we also left. And we went. The next morning, I don't recall that it was an organized effort, but the next morning, a black male student, last name was Stovall, made his way to the roof and took down the American flag and put up the black nationalist flag. Again, which was the red, black, and green flag.
Okay, now a couple of other accounts have had the flag being switched that night after the meeting, and Donald Vassar said that he was the one that did it. And I'm not really clear on whether or not there was, you know, if it happened twice,
That is the first time I've ever heard that it was taken down that night. And Donald Vassar was not at that meeting at Bethel AME Church. To my understanding, when we got to school that morning, the flag had just been switched, and students were in the front yard looking up that the flags had been switched, sort of in amazement. that the Black nationalist flag was flying over Linda McKinley. And it was said that that day that Stovall was the one who switched the flag.
I may be able to clear up something here. What Donald Bassett described is he had access to his room, the access to the roof, but in the last time we talked, he didn't actually claim responsibility for putting the flag up. But he was present. He kind of just didn't say he did.
Well,
but he only had.
I don't know, but Alan, he did say it to me.
Oh, I got it. Thank you. Yeah. Okay. Thank you for clarifying that, Sam.
It's okay. No, yeah, he said it to me. So when you saw the flag flying in the morning.
Yeah.
And how did you feel when you looked up and saw that?
I felt pride in that. Someone had taken the initiative to fly that flag over our high school. We had taken stock in the Black nationalist flag and had wanted it to replace the American flag within the school in certain areas. So that once it was replaced outside, that was a joyous occasion. It was like our high school had became our high school.
And can you talk about what happened later that day? Was there an assembly at the school, an assembly that was called,
Well, there was an assembly of such that next morning. I'm not sure who called it, but there was an assembly. Charles Ross was there at the school that morning. I think when Jim Hughes and the police officers arrived, I think they actually arrested the janitor or the custodian, maybe not knowing who Charles Ross was. But then as we went into the auditorium, as we were ushered in there by teachers and principals, Charles Ross was near the back of the auditorium and he was arrested. That we felt was very unfair. I didn't actually see the custodian being arrested. It's just my understanding that that's what took place. But we thought that the arrest of Charles Ross was very unfair because he had not incited us to do anything. He was just a guide and a counselor on some of the things that we could do and should not be in any way sanctioned for. He also gave us some information on Black people who had done things earlier in America that we may not have been aware of. Well, they came in that next morning with Jim Hughes, I believe, led them in. And they came in and they just began to tell us that we had to get into the auditorium or get into a class. We had to go somewhere. And So, you know, a number of the students were upset that now we have the Columbus police in our school telling us what to do, as if the principals and the teachers weren't enough. But now we've got these police officers here who were threatening in their posture, who took out their billy clubs as if they were going to beat us with them. And so it just put us in a position of feeling threatened. And that was a terrible feeling to have in your high school. No one should have to go through that. But we did at Lyndon McKinley.
And did you see, you mentioned when we talked, you mentioned seeing police assault students. You mentioned one particular officer, Dewey Stokes, that you saw hitting a girl. And police using racial slurs with you. And I guess they were about to arrest you and Tom Brown came around the corner and kind of intervened. Can you talk about those things a little bit?
Yes. There were a number of students that were beaten, that were caught not in the classroom, who were kind of snatched up by the police and taken to the front office. The things I spoke about to you, there was a famous black police officer who they said was, everybody said he was a dirty police officer as far as black people goes. I seen him beat a student in the front yard of the school. There was a young lady, and I had tried to see her name in our yearbook, and she would have been in the 11th grade when I graduated in the 12th grade, but I didn't see her picture in there. They had a number of the 11th graders in our yearbook, but I didn't see her picture so I could have her name. But anyway, she was on the third floor of the school, and she was coming around the corner. And when she came around the corner, Dewey Stokes and some other police officers were at that corner. And these police officers were around Dewey Stokes like he was God. And what he was the president of the FOP, the Fraternal Order of Police. And so I guess he was a God to them. And they made sure that they protected him. But as this young lady came around the corner, the bells had previously rang, and so she was stopped. And she was questioned about where she was supposed to be, and she may have given him a flip answer, and he took off into her with his billy club. I was in the hallway, and I was allowed to duck in to Mr. Bunch's class, before I had ducked into there, I had began to run down the hallway to get to his class, and one of the police officers, seen that and turned around and said, "Get that nigger." But luckily, I wasn't too fast, but luckily I was able to get to Mr. Bunch's class and be able to duck in there. And it was not my period to be in his class, but he let me come in and sit in on that particular class.
So when all of this was happening, and how did you feel then?
I felt like we had become a police state. One of the things that we used to say is that we have been occupied like the people in Beirut. At the time, they had been occupied by, I think, Israeli forces. And so we felt as if we had been occupied in the same manner, that we had no rights as students. Activities that we normally did were taken away from us. We felt like our relationships with Mr. Brown, Mr. Bunch, Mr. Davis, Mr. Hopkins, Mr. Horton, that our relationship had been changed because we didn't feel the freedom to just go up in between classes and talk to them. And they were very instrumental in helping us become young men because they told us what was right and the right thing to do. And that was removed from us. And so some of us who grew up in one-parent households, you know, had these father figures kind of taken away from us, or at least our father figures while we were in school, who told us, who counseled us in ways that made us better young men. And so the other way that it affected us, and especially me, was that the alcove was taken away. In the lunch room, we had to eat and leave the lunch room. There was no lingering around. The relationships that we had with each other as students, I think that it suffered during that time because our relationships were kind of put on hold. We may walk home to school, walk home with each other, you know, to a certain point. I lived the furthest away. Well, not the furthest away, but of my group of friends, I lived the furthest away. And so, you know, the conversations we could have as we walked home, that was pretty much it. We just couldn't sit in school and converse with each other anymore.
And can you tell us, do you feel like the experiences at Linden were traumatic? And B, how did your experiences at Linden, particularly in 1971, how did that affect your life after high school?
Well, I think that going through that put a number of students in a state of, we were just abused. We were children. Some of us had gotten to be 18, but the majority of us were children. And we had these grown men to come in and kind of be over us in an always a threatening manner. Those police officers who occupied the school never took the time to talk with us, not the black students, never took the time to talk to us to see what the issues may be or anything of that nature. It was always in a threatening posture. And that was traumatic for children. No matter what you want to say about how big we were in stature, we were children. And to have people treat us like that then, now may be frowned upon as if child abuse had taken place. And that's what it was. It was child abuse. And anybody going through a period of abuse is going to have some lingering effects from that. Probably my biggest carry away from the Linda McKinley days is that I just never thought anything of the Columbus police. I just didn't think they were shit and that they were ever gonna be shit, that they were just men whose purpose was to ride herd over the black community. And in fact, I did a paper while I was there at Linden, and I asked a black officer, why did he want to become a police officer? And his answer was to help the community. Asked the white officer the same question, and his was to make sure that law and order reigned in Columbus. And I'm sure he wasn't talking about Upper Arlington or any of the suburbs, but he was talking about that he made sure there was law and order in the black communities of Columbus.
Thank you for that. And so, can you talk about how you feel when you look around today and you see the demonstrations that are happening against police brutality, against racial violence, particularly this year? When you see that activism and you know who's actually out there in the street, does it bring back memories? What are your thoughts in general?
Well, it brings back memories because this didn't just start happening. There was a friend of mine who we went to school with. We called him Nikolai Joe. Well, Nikolai Joe's brother was killed in a house. The police shot him in the basement of a friend's house. There was a guy named Tony Flint who the police shot out on Livingston Avenue, who was a friend. And there were other police killings and abuses that led to the Justice Department taking over the Columbus police. So they never, to me, had any good intentions as far as black people in the city of Columbus.
And when you think about some of the things that the group of students that you were, you know, that you were, that group that you were a part of, wanted, separate from the police, but just the idea of fairness and fair treatment in general, which really, you know, in a way speaks to systemic racism. When you see those people demonstrating today and talking about those same issues, what are your thoughts? You know, what are your thoughts about, from your perspective of having experienced this nearly 50 years ago, what do you see as the solution in this country?
Well, I think that the solution for black people has long been the act of protesting. when you go back to the Civil Rights Act being passed, that was a lot of protesting. The right to vote for black people came about because of a lot of protesting. And so for black people, that has been what white people have understood. We don't have the means to fight police officers on a one-to-one basis or group-to-group basis. We just don't have the guns or anything that would allow us to compete with them. So protest is our way of being able to achieve some things. The Montgomery bus boycott, you know, the fairness of how persons were allowed to sit on that bus became about because of protest. So I think the protest that we have today is meaningful, purposeful, and should be taking place. I'm glad to see that it has become interracial, that some white folks have joined in. But I'm also weary of that, because what white folks have done over the years have been to kind of take the side of the black man. But when I walk in your neighborhood, I'm still a nigger. And that's going to continue. I think that those who are, especially like in Portland, Chicago, that have went and torn up and looted some of the stores and set fire to some of the areas, even here in Columbus, with the protests downtown that tore up a lot of buildings. I think that's misguided. If a police officer shoots and kills a black man, we need to protest in his neighborhood. We need to let the people in his neighborhood know specifically how we feel. And whatever happens in their neighborhood, you know, I can see justification for that. But to tear up our own neighborhoods or even our downtown areas, I just don't agree with that. I think, if, like I said, a police officer kills somebody, we need to find out where he lived, and we need to protest in his area where he lives. You know, ironically, with the COVID-19 virus here in Columbus, the lady who was over the state health department, they protested in her neighborhood about the things that she had advised Governor DeWine to put in place. And so I thought then, wow, that's a great thing. They're protesting in the neighborhood where this person lives. And so we need to do that more often. I would hate for a protest to come down Mount Vernon Avenue and damage this building or any other building in this area. I think some of the issues with the white officers shooting black men, as I said before, is nothing new. But until the Justice Department does what they need to do, I think it's going to continue to happen. You know, this last young man who was killed in Wisconsin, you know, this is done during the Republican National Convention. I mean, how brazen can you be that while the president is trying to get his story on, that a white officer would not kill a black man, but would shoot a black man in his back. And I think until the Justice Department begins to punish these white police officers, that we will be protesting this for years to come. I tell my granddaughters, both who just started driving, I had to sit down and have the talk with them and let them know what they need to do if they are stopped.
Right on. Well, can you hear me?
Yes, everybody can hear you.
Okay, great. Thank you very much this morning. Actually, you raised a really good point, because I'm thinking also about the police officers who killed Breonna Taylor.
Yeah.
Who are still, you know, to my knowledge, I don't think they've been arrested, and they're living their lives.
Yeah.
You know? So I think bringing it home would actually be a really good strategy. I know that we're behind time, and Mr. Brown is there.
Yes, he is.
I don't know if you wanted to ask Mr. Morton anything.
So well, I'll just do that very quickly
and go to the other.
Sure. Hey, Celia, I can hear you. We've got one other gentleman here with us, so I want to just give, in 1 second, we'll come to you, okay? Just touch base if there's, okay, cool. But I just wanted to make sure, in case you needed anything, if we needed to pause, because we're going to take a break in between. Cool. Perfect. Okay, and then, so Mr. Morton, I would love to talk to you again at a later time in more detail, but your energy has been really powerful. When we were talking earlier, as we walked around the building, I told you one of my areas of interest is literacy practices, what people read, is also activism. And so I'm really curious, you talked about a lot of teachers who were mentors, you talked about your knowledge of the civil rights movement and protesting, and so it made me think about this question. And I wonder, was there anything that you could recall that you read along the way? Maybe it was a sign, maybe you read it on your own and discovered it's a letter, maybe it was a speech that you heard that had any particular impact that made you want to get involved. So, was there anything that you read, really, that inspired you to want to get involved in activism? Did you believe it was the appropriate thing to do?
I think of anything that I read back then, it was the autobiography of Stokely Carmichael and the SNCC movement. And I think probably more than anything created a call to activism within myself. Also the whole spectrum of the Black Panther movement, which is what we wanted here in Columbus. Before we began to meet at John Wells' house, some of us met intermittently, and we talked about being able to create or recreate in Columbus what the Black Panthers had done in California. And that was one of our reasons for meeting with Mr. Nomo X, because he represented the Black Panther movement here in Columbus. So those two things, probably more than anything else, created my call to activism.
That's really powerful. Thank you. But I would really love it if I could follow up with you a bit of time and talk a little bit more detail about that, okay?
Sure. Okay, after 71, they removed Mr. Brown, Mr. Reed, And who was the third principal?
Mr. Steele.
Mr. Steele. They removed him from Linda McKinley, and they brought in a Mr. Anderson, Mr. Woodford, and Mr. Cattahenry, who most of us had had at Linmore at our junior high school. They were the principals there, and so they brought them to Linda McKinley, thinking that they could calm us down. And the difference between, say, Mrs. Stacy Woodford and Mr. Brown is that when we were caught doing some things that we had no business doing, and I'll be honest with those things, such as drinking beer or wine on school property, mm-hmm. or even sometimes maybe even smoking marijuana on school property. Mm-hmm. What Mr. Brown did was swift and determining into that, you know, we keep doing this under Mr. Brown's watch, we're not gonna be in school much longer. The difference when they brought in Anderson, Cattahenry, and Woodford is that their punishment was for us to go out and pick up paper around the school.
So they wanted you to have you get in prison time where you get work detail?
Yeah, and to have us go out and pick up paper really was no deterrent to us getting high at school because we did it every day. But at some point we began to quit. Under Mr. Brown's administration, because he scared the bejesus out of us, and then when they took them away, it was just a different set of men that we had to deal with. You know, to have us walk around the school and pick up paper, you know, didn't deter us from getting high the next morning at school. And sometimes when they told us to go pick up paper, we would just go down to the alcove and sit.
Every time you talk about alcove, it reminds me of something we had in Connecticut. We called it the breezeway. It was a little path with a space between buildings, really, with a cover.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.